get a first impression. Embedded Wizard Studio provides a powerful integrated development environment permitting you to simply design, test and customize your GUI application. The workflow is based on the idea of visually added programming, where software entities are arranged and connected with a mouse by dragging and dropping them. From our point of view, it was self-evident to combine visual programming and the GUI application development. Both concepts complement each other. In this manner, you compose the appearance of an application and implement its complete functionality. No further development tools are needed. So let's continue with a quick tour. In the middle area of Embedded Wizard, you see the so-called Composer. This is the main editor of Embedded Wizard. Within the Composer, you see many gray rectangles. The small rectangles are called bricks. Every brick represents an individual member within the project. The shape of the brick, its icon, and the text at its upper edge describe the exact function of this brick. For example, the brick named Win32 represents the profile member, a member needed to configure general project and target specific parameters. The large gray rectangles are called annotations. They have no real function in the application. They exist only to leave comments or to group bricks together visually. So don't worry about them too much. Depending on the type, the bricks contain diverse attributes and properties. These appear in the inspector window on the right-hand side of the composer after the affected brick has been selected. For this purpose, just single-click on the brick Win32 to select it. Now you can see its attributes in the inspector. The profile brick Win32 exposes the attributes platform package, screen size, and others. As you see, the attribute platform package is actually configured with a value Tara Win32 RGBA 8888. This means that by using this profile, the Embedded Wizard Studio will generate a code optimized for Microsoft Windows operating systems with RGBA 8888 as a native color format for all images. Selecting other value in this attribute would allow you to generate code for other target systems or color formats. The attribute screen size, as it implies, determines the desired target display resolution, in our example 480x272 pixels. In the case of Windows as a target system, this gives a hint about the dimension of the window when the application is running. If you intend to create an application, for example for Raspberry Pi, you will configure this attribute to correspond to the native resolution of the display of your target system. Depending on the type of project member, the corresponding brick may contain further embedded members. You can show them by simply double-clicking on the member, similar to how you would open a folder in the Windows File Explorer. Please take a look at the brick named Application. Bricks of this type represent the so-called units. A unit is a container where you put your dedicated implementation. It's similar to a namespace in C++. Now, double-click on the brick application to show its content. Thus, the content enclosed within the unit application is shown in a new composer page. During the work with Embedded Wizard, you will often switch between various composer pages. All open pages are listed as tabs in the navigation bar at the upper edge of the composer. Now you can see that the tab representing the main composer of the project and another associated to the just opened application unit. Within the unit, all enclosed members are similarly represented by bricks. As you can see, many of them have different icons and names. Please note the bricks with pointed edges. Such bricks represent data entities. They store information. For example, the brick background beans serves as a bitmap resource. It contains an image. Now, select the brick background beans. Thereupon, the inspector shows its associated attributes. Among the various attributes of the just selected brick, please also note the attribute file name. This attribute addresses the image file to associate with this bitmap resource. When generating source code, Embedded Wizard converts this image file into a format that is appropriate for your target system. This usually includes the color reduction and compression. Later, when you want to display the image, you simply refer to the member background beans. Now, click on the brick small font to select it. It represents a font resource. As you see in the inspector, the font resource is configured with the font name ASAP Condensed Medium and the font size of 29 pixels. So when generating source code, Embedded Wizard will automatically convert the specified font in a format that is appropriate for your target system. This usually includes the rasterization and compression of all affected font glyphs. Later, when you want to display text with this font, you can simply refer to the member small font. Besides the above mentioned bitmap and font resources, you can see the unit containing a few other bricks. Let's take a look at the three bricks grouped together below the annotation configuration objects. These bricks represent the so-called auto objects. Such global objects contain various settings that are important for the GUI application. Because an object is a data entity, the bricks are also shown with pointed edges. Now select the brick pushButtonConfig. The inspector shows the properties of the object. In the upper text row of the selected brick, you see the expression widgets set pushButtonConfig. This expression identifies a class from which this object is instantiated. The particular origin of the object is also reflected in its icon. Here you see a small button with an associated gear wheel as a symbol for configuration. Embedded Wizard follows an object-oriented approach to structure and implement GUI applications. This implies that when developing a GUI application, you need to create and implement classes. Objects are instances of the corresponding classes. The just mentioned auto objects are nothing else than global instances you can access from everywhere in your project. A class, in turn, can implement either a visual GUI component, like a push button, or a non-visual component, like the configuration object. The class widgetsSetPushButtonConfig implements such non-visual configuration component. Please note the four properties face active, face default, face disabled and face focused. They determine the bitmap resources to be displayed in push buttons using this configuration object. In other words, when you connect a push button with a configuration object pushButtonConfig, the push button will use the specified bitmap resources for its appearance. Now, you might want to know where the class widgetsSetPushButtonConfig comes from and where the pushButton components are implemented. Well, all these classes are part of the so-called Mosaic Framework, a component library which serves as a basement for every GUI application created with Embedded Wizard. If you recall the content of the first composer, just as we started, there you will find an annotation Mosaic Framework grouping 7 unit bricks. These units contain the implementation of the Mosaic Framework. In particular, the unit widget set implement all widgets, including the pushButton component, as well as the associated configuration objects. Every unit, by the way, serves as a namespace for its enclosed members. This helps to avoid eventually name conflicts with members existing in other units. For example, the class name widgetsSetPushButtonConfig addresses the class pushButtonConfig within the unit widgetset. As such, it does not interfere with the identically named autoObject pushButtonConfig existing within the unit application. Both coexist within the same project. Next to that, you see within the unit application many other bricks. The bricks here, for example, contain the implementation of the interface between the GUI and the real device. In other words, the bricks take care of the communication with the device. In our QuickTour project, the interface is limited to start and stop the device and to query its actual status. The exact implementation of these bricks is not important at this moment. We will learn more about it later. Much more interesting at this moment are the bricks grouped together below the annotation GUI components. These three bricks are classes which implement visual GUI components. For example, the brick selection dialog implements a screen, we call it dialog, where the user can select the desired strength of the coffee. The brick brewing dialog in turn implements a dialog showing the progress of the brewing process. Usually, when developing a new GUI application, you will first identify the components needed to assemble it. You will list all dialogs or screens the user may interact with, as well as any other subordinated widgets the application should contain, for example a push button, slider or progress bar. Then, in the second step, you will implement every identified component as an individual class. Click on the brick selection dialog. As in previous cases, the attributes of the selected bricks are shown in the inspector window. Most especially, take note the attribute superclass of the just selected brick. It is actually initialized with the expression core group. By the way, the same value is also displayed in the upper text row of the brick. This expression indicates that the class selection dialog is derived from another class, core group. This superclass in turn is implemented in the Mosaic framework, which we have explained just before. The class core group implements a lot of common functionality needed by almost every GUI component. It takes care of screen updates and dispatches incoming user input events received, for example, from a touchscreen or a keyboard. By deriving from it, the class selection dialog inherits all this functionality implicitly. it is not necessary to re-implement this functionality again. In the derived class, you just add new contents specific to this component. This is one of the advantages of the object-oriented approach. Now, let's double-click on the brick selection dialog to show its content. The content of the class selection dialog appears in a new composer page. This composer, however, is different. In the top left corner, you see an area surrounded by a thick blue border. This area is called canvas. What you see within this area will also be visible on the display of your target device. The canvas area is available only when the currently edited class represents a visual GUI component. In our tutorial example, this GUI component permits the user to select the desired coffee strength and to start the brewing process. Typically, complex GUI projects will consist of many different GUI components, which, depending on the user interaction, appear and disappear on the display. The selection dialog component implements just one of the GUI components. Now please take a look at the inspector window. In its upper area, you see a list of members. As you have probably noticed, this list always corresponds to what you see in the composer. When working with Embedded Wizard, you can select the members either in the composer or in the inspector. Both work coupled together. Within this list, you can also rename the members or rearrange their order if necessary. Here, however, the inspector lists much more members than shown in the composer. In the composer, you only see some visual members within the canvas area and a few bricks. Nothing else. The inspector, in turn, lists 100 members. You can see this here in the inspector's column order. The difference roots in the object-oriented character of Embedded Wizard. In this particular case, the actually edited class derives from the superclass core group. As explained before, the derived class inherits all the functionality of its parent class and also of all higher superclasses. Displaying all those inherited members in the composer would quickly become confusing. Therefore, when you edit a class, the composer conceals implicitly the bricks for members, which are defined in the ancestor classes but not overridden in the actual class. In other words, the composer shows only those bricks which are added or modified in the actual class and hides all other inherited and not overridden bricks. The inspector, in turn, always displays all members. Those which are inherited appear in the inspector in gray color. New members added to the actually edited class appear black. In this manner, you can easily recognize the origin of a member.